Right, that is where I want to say, folks, a special good afternoon, a special greetings, a special welcome to all those of you already here with us in the viewing and listening audience this afternoon. Welcome to the program called Civic Vibes each and every Sunday from the 5 o'clock hour this afternoon. We're going to have a very, very interesting, very informative program at that. We have two special guests here with us this afternoon in the name of Mrs. Selma St. Pri and also Mr. Dean Jules out of St. Lucia. We're going to have a candid discussion with them in just a while, so I ask you to please stay tuned for that discussion coming up in just a bit. Today being the 9th of October, 2022, sort of wet outside, you know, our folks from St. Lucia told us it is very wet their way, but, you know, we always thank God for the weather the farmers needed at times, so we want to thank God no matter what the weather is like at this time. All of you already here, David, Andre, Franklin Timothy, Stephanie John Baptist, Dave Bertrand, Randy Cheney, Janjan Joseph. Thank you very, very much, those of you already here with us. Please share the live as we're about to have a very, very informative program here this afternoon. This afternoon, we have also with us here Paula Celestine, the host of this program, and also our buddy here, Brother Alvin Thomas. So without further ado, before we go to our special invited guest this afternoon, let me move across to Paula Celestine so that she can give her opening remarks right here as we move along. Paula, good afternoon to you.
Good afternoon to you, Lofty, and how are you doing?
I'm doing pretty well, Paula, pretty well.
Okay, good. Lofty, it is indeed a very wet day. Our day is very wet, but we have to give God thanks and praise because I know there are a number of farmers all over the island. They are very happy to have this shower, you know, especially for their vegetables and their fruits and all of this. So I want to say special Sunday afternoon to all our viewers, those at home and those abroad in whatever part of the world you are. I want to say thank you for making Civic Vibes what it has been, because without you, the viewers, there would have maybe been no Civic Vibes. So to all our viewers out there, blessed Sunday afternoon. To our guests here, I want to say a special Sunday afternoon to you all, taking time out from your maybe schedule this afternoon, maybe where you could be taking a very good rest. I want to say good afternoon to Miss Zelma and Mr. Dane. Nice having you all joining us this afternoon and looking forward for a very informative conversation here. And also to Mr. Alvin Thomas. Mr. Alvin Thomas is no longer a guest, Lofty. This man is part of us here, and he makes it the point of duty every Sunday afternoon to do just that. So, special Sunday afternoon to each and everyone. Thank you, Lofty.
Yes, thank you very much, Paula, for your opening remarks, your opening salvo, as it were. Let's move across to Mr. Thomas for his opening remarks as well. Alvin.
Well, thank you, Lofty. I'd also like to join yourself and Paula in saying a special good afternoon to our many fans online already, as I can see myself on the feed, those who are on Facebook, YouTube, whatever platform you're on, special good afternoon. As I've already been indicated, we know it's a wet afternoon in Dominica as well as in St. Lucia, but notwithstanding, the fans are here with us and they're tuned in. Special good afternoon to our guests, Dean and Selma. Good to have you guys. It's always good when Lofty weekend. We can collaborate with our friends in the region. Bear in mind, we are one piece of land. It just happened by accident. There's some water dividing us. But quite frankly, when you travel throughout the islands, you notice how connected we are, both in terms of our culture, of our lifestyle, you name it. So it's always good when we can have some of our folks from the region to collaborate and to discuss some of those issues with us. So I say welcome, and I'm looking forward to a very engaging and enlightening conversation this afternoon.
Yes, indeed. Brother Thomas, thank you very much for your opening remarks as well. Let me just run through the lineup for this afternoon's conversation, folks, before we invite our guests here to give their opening remarks. The first segment we'll be having them, that is Mrs. Selma St. Pri. That is the last time I'll be saying the Saint Pri. It is giving me a little tongue twister. So Selma for short and sweet. And also we'll be having Brother Dean Jules as well, the PRO that is of that organization. We'll be going to that organization in just a bit. Selma is the general manager of that organization. That organization is known as the National Skills Development Center, and that is based in St. Lucia. We're going to hear them talk about a very innovative idea. Well, I think it is past idea now. It is action. What they have been doing so far, especially with the young people over there, as to food sustainability, food security, and just how they're using their resources in a very wise manner over there in St. Lucia. We too in Dominica, we can learn a bit from them this afternoon. So I ask of you to please share the information here as we are moving on. So that will do it for the first segment. They are here with us until the 6 o'clock hour this afternoon. Then the next segment from the 6 o'clock hour, we have Brother Pastor Jack. He'll be coming to talk to us on a topic that Pastor Jack is not a stranger to, helping feed the homeless, helping feed the less fortunate among us. So Pastor Jack will be sharing with us this afternoon as well. And then the third segment, the man, Brother Alvin, you heard from him, he will be taking the lead on that discussion, where we'll be continuing to focus on that CCG report that was handed down to Dominica, whereby the CCG persons are saying to Dominicans, our tainted elections in Dominica, we should fix them before any other general election is held in Dominica. So that, in a nutshell, folks, it is what we have for you planned this afternoon in terms of conversation. So without further ado, let me move across to our special invited guest and say a special good afternoon to the general manager of that organization, that is the National Skills Development Center, based in St. Lucia. Mrs. Selma, good afternoon to you in a very special way.
Oh, good afternoon. It is such a pleasure and an honor to be here together with you. And, you know, we always believe that we have to collaborate. And collaborating with our sister, Dominica, is really an honor and a pleasure. And we're hoping that it will not just be a conversation and sure, that it will go further and be sustainable as it relates to that the work we're doing and the things that we're doing in St. Lucia as it relates to agriculture and agro-processing and other things that come with it. Because, you know, in our age, we, for the new generation, we have to add digitization to whatever it is we do. So we're looking forward to the conversation and hoping that it could go further. Yes, you said I'm the general manager of the National Skills Development Center. I don't think there's anything else I need to add to introduce myself, but I'm just looking forward to the conversation this afternoon.
Thank you very, very much indeed, Selma. We'll get back to you in just a bit so that you can dive a little deeper in the meat of the discussion. Let me move across to our brother here, the PRO of that organization, and Mr. Dean Jules, special greetings as well.
Yes, good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon, Dominica. Good afternoon, St. Lucia, our Facebook, Instagram fans. Good afternoon to all of you. And it is a pleasure to be here on this program today. So, of course, as I have been introduced correctly, I'm the Public Relations Office of the National Skills Development Center. The other exciting thing about myself as well is that I'm also a farmer.
Wow, that's good. That's good.
So it's my new project. So, of course, I'm going to be excited to actually discuss farming and agro-processing on this program.
Yes, indeed. Thank you very much, guys, you both, for making yourself here this Sunday afternoon here and speaking to our many fans and viewers as we're moving on. What we're going to do now, just to set the tone for the discussion to follow, I got a clip from, I think, a local radio station, Hot 7 News, that is. So it is compliments them. The clip that you're going to see now and hear from, let me give Hot 7 News the credit in that department. So we're going to try to load up that clip now, and then we're going to get into the meat of the discussion, because that clip will for sure set the discussion to come.
The National Skills Development Center has introduced a course in agro-processing. According to the Public Relations Officer of the NSDC, Dane Jules, 30 scholarships have been made available to members of the public who are interested in the field of agro-processing.
The National Skills Development Center will be offering some free scholarships for persons interested in agro-processing. The more exciting thing about it is also that for those persons who have been selected for that program,
they will additionally be getting some financial support for traveling, etc. So there will be some stipends available in addition to the course being offered. Those courses will be offered. Actually, we're inviting all persons from all sectors. I mean, even though persons are already employed or already in the field, we actually are making it available to them as well.
He has encouraged members of the public to sign up for the program and indicate whether they would rather morning or afternoon courses. Jules says the program is scheduled to commence on August 29th. He notes that food security has been an area of concern. As such, the NSDC is finding ways to remedy such concerns.
In the midst of even this pandemic, one of the questions that popped up most was, you know, food. What happens to our food? Even right now, we can see that there has been an upsurge in the cost of food as well. And as a result of that, I mean, the NSDC has seen it necessary to ensure that not just we create employability, because a lot of persons have been relieved from their work. We have persons, and not just that, but even in the agricultural sector as well, we have persons who produce. What happens to that excess? You know, so we have found a methods of ensuring that, you know, we're able to recycle. Businesses can use, you know, whatever produce that they have and, you know, create a different good or commodity with it.
He says all programs are inclusive, as 10% of the classroom space is reserved for individuals with disabilities. Reporting for Hot 7 News, I am Genevieve Gonzaga.
All right, again, we want to thank Hot 7 News for that clip that you just heard and saw. Let us get right into it, starting with the general manager of the NSDC in St. Lucia. Selma, let me ask you, first of the bat, can you give us a little better scope as to just why that program came about?
Well, what was happening is that we have part of our cohort, a large part of our cohort are persons who are disadvantaged, mm-hmm. you know, persons who lie on the poverty belts of St. Lucia. And like Mr. Jules was saying, we realized there was a food security problem. We realized that a lot of them, when they come, sometimes we, even when they come to class, we have to provide food for them. A number of them come from homes that have farmers or have land. Some of them themselves were farmers who were displaced and were not able to help themselves. You know, some of them, they have their produce, they have a lot of what they have, but they do not have the skills and the information to take it further, to help themselves business-wise, or to you know, collaborate with another business. So what we decided to do was to give them the skills that they needed, give them the know-how, because sometimes you give people skills to know how to do something, because, you know, it's technical vocational education training that we do. But they really do not have the financial background. They do not have the employability skills. You know, they do not have the work ethic that they need, mm-hmm. you know, to go forward and make it work. So that's what we do. We give them the counseling, career counseling. We give them, you know, the employability and work ethic skills. Then we give them the hardcore skills where they could go and either gain wage employment or start a small business for themselves. Now, things are getting so expensive and they cannot buy a lot of the things that they need. And so in using and planting those things, you use it not only as wage or self-employment, but you also use it for your food, for yes. your living. Mm-hmm. So all of that, you know, would help, you know, sustain. And having an organization that collaborate with others to help and work with them continuously. Because sometimes it's hard to be able to sell your produce to the right places. And, you know, in helping people do that, you find that, you know, and some of them, if they don't have a plot of land, we have attained a lot of land, 3 acres plus, so that, you know, we could assist them in doing what they need to do for those who doesn't have enough. So working together, collaborating is the key so that we could go forward and help our people in St. Lucia, you know, not only gain employment and have self-sustainable goals, meet their self-sustainable goals, but also feed themselves.
Indeed. Let me ask just another question here before we move across to the PRO of that organization. Are you guys any getting help? Are you guys, sorry, getting any help that is from the powers that be, the government? How do you guys sustain that project financially?
Well, Well, we do have a small subvention that we get from the government to help with the salaries of some of the staff and some of our overheads. But what we have done over the years is that we have a small farm that we had started out of a class. It started as a crop production class. And we use that farm is in the country in Monrepo. We started off there where we produced a lot of the foods we needed. We also, to help us sustain, we also started, you know, a canteen, and we have a restaurant in one of the buildings that we built through projects. Yes. And, you know, restaurant, and we do our own catering. So we use a lot of the foods we plant ourselves to do, you know, our seasonings, to cook, to do different things with it. So you see that over the years, we have been helping sustain ourselves as well, because you have to help yourself. The government can never give you everything you need. So in doing so, we realized a lot of the needs of others. So it came from a class and developed, you know, into, you know, a business, a small business, nonprofit though, because a lot of the proceeds that we make go back into training and skills for the young people and older people as well in certain instances. But to answer you directly, a small amount is given, but most of it we do through donor funds as well as for our own sustainable initiatives.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Brother Jules, you are the quote-unquote spokesman for this organization that you're talking about.
Yes, sir.
In terms of the reception on the ground by St. Lucians, in terms of that special program, what is the feedback like?
Yeah, so in terms of the reception, to be honest, of course, we did appeal to everyone, young persons, older persons as well. But we are really seeing more of the older persons coming out. We do have a few younger persons, and we are excited about that we can say, you know what, in a few years from now, that there will still be some persons within that food industry to ensure that we have continued food security. But right now, most of the persons who are really invested and excited about this program are the older persons.
Okay, good. And the elderly, they are taking advantage of that program.
Yes.
Older.
Older persons.
Yes. So let us say persons within the age, maybe over 35.
Okay.
We have more persons from 35, maybe towards there. Maybe 45, 50, we've been at that age range. We have more persons taking advantage than the younger age.
Okay.
But not elderly.
Okay, well, that's very good. That's very good.
Yes.
I would want to think that the younger persons now would want to take advantage of that as well. Do you think that you guys maybe could be doing something extra or something more to, you know, sort of appeal to these younger persons in St. Lucia?
Well, yes. Sorry. What we have been doing, the last agro-processing class that we had a number of younger persons, but that were persons who were already interested in the area. You find the new ones that are interested now, they're more into the technological aspect and, you know, the business aspect of it.
Okay.
You, as it relates to, and so we try to attract them in that perspective. We try to get those because they want to do some of the labeling, some of the sales and marketing aspects of it. So a lot of the business aspects, they're more interested in that. They're interested in digitization. They're interested in using new technologies as it relates to their work. Some of them are not really much keen on the crop production aspect of it. Although some of them are, but the majority into the sales and marketing, labeling, you know, and that kind of thing, because you know the finished product and all of that. So we don't have a problem with that, you know, in working with some of them in that aspect, because that is one of the most important parts. If you want to import or put it on the shelves, we shop with our eyes.
Yes.
So the aspect of labeling, you know, and having that nice, you know, attractive bottle or can or whatever it is on the shelf is important for them, you know, as it relates to how the machinery that is used. They do not want to they want the most, how should I say, up-to-date machinery.
Yes.
Because you know that young people nowadays, they're into technology and into all the new things. And we have to be prepared, you know, so that they could come and be a part of it all. So these are some of the things that they talk about, because we have been talking to a lot of them, interviewing them on what they think is best. Because, you know, you have to engage them to get them involved so that they would, you know, be a part of. And these are some of the ideas and some of the things they see that most of them are interested in.
Yeah, wow. So far, so good. Let me move across to Brother Thomas here so that he can chime in on the conversation.
Thank you, Lofty. Thank you. I just want to kind of follow up the question you asked Dane earlier. I mean, when I look at the screen, he says earlier on he's a farmer. And I think he has to re-emphasize that. So those looking at, I see a youthful face there.
Yeah,
The face might be fooling me, but I see a youthful face.
It's youthful.
Okay. So my question to Dane is that, what is it? I mean, you're a farmer, you're a young farmer at that.
Yes.
As communication officer, what skills or how do you come across to other young people who say, hey, look, I'm doing this and this thing is working? How do you come across? Because that's always a challenge. How do we get our young people engaged, whether it's in politics, in business, or what have you? What's the strategy that you use?
I have this phrase that I go by, and it's the money's in the mud. The money's in the mud. And you look at gold, where does gold come from? Diamonds, everything's in the mud, you know? And we relate that also to food, agriculture. Again, how many times a day do we eat? 3 times, some people 4, some people 5 times a day. So there's a continuous need for food, you know? And I've recognized that. And again, believe me, speaking to some farmers, even in St. Lucia, they actually give testaments of their experiences in terms of that farming can be very viable in terms of, you know, the outcome, financial outcome of it. And of course, I've capitalized on that idea, and I realize, yeah, I think there is that possibility, because again, we're not just talking about feeding one island or just feeding a community. What about, I mean, there's an entire world, people, the entire world needs food continually. So, I mean, there's always a need for food. So I understand that. And I said, you know what? I'm going to go into farming.
Yes, indeed. Alvin, anything? Any follow-up? Any?
So by way of a follow-up now, and I'm glad the point that you just made, the world needs food. Maybe we'll get to that later on when Lofty, as we get further into the discussion. But in terms of the marketing, how do you get the surplus out? Because that is one of the challenges I know we have in Dominica. Mm-hmm. Sometimes the farmers say, well, okay, we produce, but we can't sell it.
Yes,
it stays and it rots on the farm. Yeah. But in your case, from what the Selma said so far, you got a canteen, you got a restaurant, you do catering. So from what I can sense, there's no waste in a way. So how are you able to get that produce outside, not just consuming St. Lucia, but outside of St. Lucia?
Okay, that's a good question, because we do sell some of our produce. Well, all the good produce that we have, we do sell it to Massey stores. We actually do that as well. I forgot to put that in, but you asked the right question. And these are some of the examples that some of the young people as well saw, and they wanted to be a part of. When they actually saw us, you know, being able to sell our produce, because every class that come in, they assist us in, or we make sure that they assist us in all the different aspects, from the crop production to selling it, to packaging it, to labeling it, to weighing it, you know, to looking and examining to see which are the best ones that would go to the supermarkets and all of that. So a lot of that aspect is done. We at the NSDC, we believe that, you know, whatever aspect it is, we need to train people in those areas to ensure that, you know, if they want to form a cooperative or they want to, you know, go out there and form partnerships, they could come together and do just that through us. So how we do it is that we sit with Massey. When we have the powers that be, we sit with them as well. We ensure that we bring some of the young persons along So they could take examples from, you know, the exchange, you know, because we want them to know how to attract employers, you know, to their produce, to whatever it is they want to sell. So we do have that round table, that sit down where we actually try to bid and get, you know, our best produce out there and get the best price, of course, to sell our produce so that, you know, we could make enough money to help those trainees. So that is how we do it. And a lot of times what we do is we try to show the stores that when they collaborate, they are also doing their CSR, which is their corporate social responsibility, because we actually taking care of our poor, our disadvantaged, our future, which is the young people, our human resource, and show them the necessity for that as we go forward. So a lot of that is done in the background to ensure, you know, that we have that kind of collaboration. And we actually do, because Marcy, they always ask us for certain things. There was one time there was no broccoli on island, and we jumped to the challenge and we actually, in the season of no broccoli, we actually were able to, you know, get it going. And there were a lot of young people, I should say, in that group that helped our farmer Desmond to get it forward. And we were able to produce broccoli at the time, you know, to make some monies. And of course, you know, we had to share in what we, in our gleanings with the young people. But the extra, like you say, the extra, we use it at our canteen, at our restaurant. And some of it, you know, is utilized by the young people as well. And us at NSDC, what we believe in, we also set example. We buy our own produce. Instead of going out there and buy produce somewhere else, we buy our own produce, mm-hmm, to help the company and to help the trainees.
Wow. Excellent. So far.
Excellent. Thank you. Excellent.
Yes. Folks, you can chip in your questions, comments, feedback in the live feed, and we'll try our very best to get them to our special invited guests here from St. Lucia. We're talking to Selma and Mr. Jules out of St. Lucia on a very innovative program that they have over in St. Lucia. Paula, let me move across to you now so that you can chime in.
Yeah, Lofty, thank you. Lofty, I'm listening to this very interesting conversation here this afternoon. And I took a few notes. When Selma said that about the correct counseling, I took note of that, because it's not like just giving people, like she mentioned earlier also about the skills. It's not like just giving people the things and just say, okay, just go your way. They counsel them and ensure that they go the right direction. So by doing that, the people are very much aware of what next that they have to do. When she mentioned about the restaurant, Mr. Thomas touched a little on that. I can recall some time back, I mentioned something about like where the young people, if they grow their own provision and vegetables and whatever, and they have a market, and I pointed out, for example, like let's say the hospital. So it's like they grow this, it's like they assist them in doing it, and then they find the market for them. And this is exactly what that the gentleman and the lady is speaking about here this afternoon, because it's not just giving them the material, grow it, and they doesn't have a market. They are being assisted as well. And I believe if we can go this way here in Dominica, this can take us very, very far, especially the young persons who would want to go into agriculture and they doesn't want to just go planting and doesn't know the next way out. So she also mentioned about the scholarship, Lofty, 30 scholarships here, and they give them the stipend if in case they have to travel and all of this. I think this is wonderful. And I think something setting up here in Dominica like this, this can encourage the young people. So far, it's like, that's my observation. Yeah. Thank you.
All right. So far, so good. We'll get to some of the comments in just a while, but we'll also get to the scholarship aspect in just a while. But Brother Dane, I want to ask you, can you give us an idea of the plant itself? Give us an idea from starting to finish product. How do you guys go about, let's say, You can zero in one product or two products if you want, but just give us an idea how it functions, how it operates.
Okay, when you say a plant, what exactly are you? Can you just
the agro-processing factory or plant or whatever you guys have? How, for example, let's say I saw in the ad cauliflower, right? What do you guys do with the cauliflower from let's say start to finish in terms of the agro-processing aspect of it?
Okay, so let us take a look at, for instance, let's say cucumbers, for instance, right?
Yes, yes.
Uh-huh. So one of the things that I was really excited about after one of our classes ended previously, it was really amazing to actually taste a relish, cucumber relish. So, of course, we planted our own cucumbers right on the farm, and we have those students coming in, those who are practicing the agro-processing. They're able to harvest those cucumbers, and I mean, to transform that into a beautiful relish. I mean, and the taste, believe me, it was amazing. It was ready for the chef, you understand? And that is what it is. So I believe if we look at all of our products, like you have tomatoes, what happens to all these excesses? If you can take those tomatoes, show them how to make ketchup, show them how to make a sauce, and that is what we need to do. That is what the youth need to understand. That is what people need to know how to recycle all of our, because there are so many things, mangoes, you know, all of those different fruits that, wasting, you know, waste all the time. So that is what agro-processing is all about. We want to show persons and teach them how to use those resources effectively.
And let me just add, if you don't mind, sure, one of the things that touched me, the relish touched him most, but one of the things that really I really loved was, you know, all of us have bananas. Dominica, I'm sure, have a lot of bananas all over the place. They took green bananas and made porridge with it in the agro-processing class. And that was so amazing. You know, I was and used some of the spices, our kernel,
yes,
and
yes,
some of those things in it. And people could not believe it was green banana porridge. Wow. And a lot of people were subscribing to it. That there's one girl in the north now, she works with this guy who does coconuts. He sells his coconuts in the Massey stores. He worked in collaboration with us. And that's another thing. We tried to collaborate with a lot of people who had gone before and who have done it well. So people on the market, get them involved in it. And let me tell you, that porridge, boy, I wish I could send some for you. But, you know, we have green bananas everywhere, and it's something we could utilize. And you see, the thing is that it's cheap, because you plant it in your yard, in your backyard. Mostly everybody have banana trees. And you could actually utilize that, you know, to make your porridge, that kind of thing. So it's really good. And let me just say that we had stopped, but we want to start back. We used to use, you know, the pulp, the old pulp of the banana trees. We used to use that to make special paper envelopes. And the tourists used to love that, let me tell you.
Wow.
You know, you see the little fiber in between in the nice paper and envelopes. And they used to, you know, our machine went bad, and we're trying to see, somebody took a machine of ours too. So we're trying to see how we could get that back, because it was really making a good mark and good money for the NSDC. And so things like that, you know, pop, little things that we have that does not cost us a lot. So it's cost effective, and then you could make good money out of it. And when the young people hear and see these things, you know, that's some of the things they get interested in. I just wanted to throw that in.
Yes, 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 indeed. Coming on the heels of this pandemic that we just had, I heard in the ad that at least food security was mentioned. Brother Dean, can you give us an idea of how is that program adding to, you know, you guys in St. Lucia being able to sustain your food in a very effective way?
Again, it's a few things, right? Again, we're encouraging persons to embrace agriculture, okay? If everyone can embrace agriculture, that means we'll have a continuous supply of food. So that is the first thing. So not just that, but again, managing our waste as well. Again, like I said earlier, what happens to those extras, because, you know, we're farming, right? You will find out at certain times there might be an excess of maybe, let's say mangoes, an excess of cucumbers, etc. What happens to those excess? And at next time there's none. So that is what we should be trying to teach persons how to do. manage those excesses. You know, you take them, you turn them into a different product, you know, so you can use them at a different time, a different date, turn it into a different product, you know, and that is what we are looking to do. So if we're able to get that done, you know, we try to encourage, you know, proper storage, you know, of those materials as well to ensure that there is a consistent supply. And that is what we're trying to head to.
So what in essence, and part of what you were saying is that a lot of the excess, we store them, we freeze a lot of it. So at times, you know, the story of Joseph. So at the times when, you know, you it's not, because some of our things are seasonal. And, you know, so at times what happened is a lot of excess, you take it pulp, you make pulp out of it, different things, and you freeze it. We make our own juices here at NSDC too, a lot of the juices, and we actually freeze them. During that time, what we used to do, we used to make, during the pandemic, small bottles, because you know, it has to be sanitary. Yes. So we would make a lot of small bottles of juices. So when people come in, when the students come in, we have, you know, juice to give them, you know, something to eat, because some of them come in and they're from the poverty belts and they cannot feed themselves. And, you know, you cannot work with empty minds. So, you know, they would get, you know, some of those things, but freezing things and, you know, putting things away, storing things for another day, very sustainable.
Yes, indeed. Brother Thomas, I'm coming to you in a while, but Margot LaRocque is writing here. This is exactly what Dominica needs. Factories manufacturing food products. That is a comment from Margot. And yes, Margot, we agree with that comment. That is why we have these two people from St. Lucia basically giving us an idea of what we can do here in Dominica as well. So we agree with you, Margot, 110% in that aspect. Brother Thomas.
Thank you, Lofty. Man, just listening to Selma and Dane, I mean, this is a program that we have to continue, Lofty. I mean, I can't see us digging into everything here this afternoon. So I'm letting you know, Dean and Selma, you guys are going to be back on that program because...
Yeah, and maybe we could bring some young people to talk and show you what they've done.
Exactly. I mean, I'm so blown away by this success story. Basically, that's what it is. I'm blown away, man. I'm telling Wonderful. You, sitting Wonderful. There in pop and saying, wow. And that is the issue that I have and I'm so passionate about. That if it can happen in St. Lucia, why can't it happen in Dominica? What's
That's
different?
That's right. You're right.
You know what I'm saying? What's different? And it permeates across everything, you know, politics as well. I always get in there.
That's important, Thomas. I'm sorry, I can call you that, Alan.
That's fine. Yeah.
That's very important because what we subscribe to, we do not subscribe to any politics.
Exactly.
We when we speak, we ensure that it's about our people, our future, True. And all of that. No politics. Because exactly. when that comes in the way, you know, when you have a leader in an organization that allows politics to come in, then that's it.
Right. So my question, I have two for you. I'm not sure how many of them, or three rather. One, I know you said earlier that the projects got off the ground on the 29th of August. I'm not sure if I got that correct or something to the effect of August 29th, but maybe I misheard. But in terms of land utilization,
the class you're starting that new
one. In terms of land utilization, because what I kind of get a sense from you is that there is you have a proper land use management because you have cauliflower, you have mangoes, you have this one, you have that fruit, cabbage, tomatoes. So in terms of land utilization, what does that look like? What kind of acreage, what kind of size that you manage your farm? That are different species around different plots. And the other question I have, the hotels, I know St. Lucia has a much more thriving tourism industry than we have in Dominica. Do you also supply the hotels with produce? Are you collaborating with them? And just the last one, I hope Dean can answer. This is a blueprint that I think that can be worked in other islands. So to what extent are you guys, once this thing gets to the level where it becomes a good success, to take it to Dominica, to go to St. Kitts, to go to Grenada, wherever that is needed. I can see you guys being ambassadors, young ambassadors in the farming business.
Right. Well, you see, what we started with a small farm, we started out with a small farm, and what we did smartly was that we got produce from other areas, from other farmers. So we trained other farmers and had other farmers in on it because we didn't have all the acreage that we had. So we had to be smart about it. So we have a center in Monrepo that is on, I think it's a little less than, it's about an acre or a little more, something like that. About an acre or a little less. And we utilize greenhouses and we utilize every edge of the back of the farm to plant different things. And there is a turn, I don't know if you understand, there's a turnover in the soil at a point where sometimes you have to change the crop around, you know, to ensure that it thrives. And so sometimes Christmas we would make, the sorrel, white and red sorrel, you know, to sell. And, you know, with tomatoes and all of that, you have to keep changing. Sometimes when the soil is a problem, what we would do is we would use, you know, sargassum and other things and make a mix of mulch and stuff so that, you know, we would not get, you know, some of the creatures that come and eat all your crop and, you know, have, you know, once in a while, you know, we would have a little issue, but then we would find a way around it. So we would get people, experts in the soil. So we collaborate with agriculture. So a number of people are involved to ensure that it happens. And so we were working with other farmers. We had a program where we trained farmers and they would help us with produce as well. What we also did was we negotiated with one of those people who had a lot of land. And he gave us permission unconditionally to use his land and gave us 3 acres. And what he told us in return for that particular land, all he wanted is for it to be organic. That's all. And so we had to find, you know, means and ways to utilize the land. We have not used it to its max yet, but we're working on doing that. So, you know, it's a lot of collaboration, working with farmers, you know, and using our farm. Pardon?
It's in the private sector as well.
Yes, in the private sector as well. And you know, all of that. So it all comes together, you know, when you do all of these things to make it work.
Yeah, I think Brother Thomas had a question as well for
you
Dean. Yes.
Dean.
The last yes, question. Can you repeat the question again?
No, I was asking in terms of providing some of the supplies to the hotel, yes. In St. Lucia, is that an area too? I know you mentioned Massey, but are the hoteliers an area? And the last one was, how do you see yourself using that as a blueprint, a template
to move
the rest of the region?
Okay. Well, currently in terms of us, you know, supplying the hotels, we haven't actively gone into that niche as yet. But right now we're in collaboration with SLHGA, in terms of being able to partner with them to supply produce.
Yes, actually next week they will be meeting Dr. King and the SLHDA Director Narani Aziz will be meeting with me next week.
All right, indeed. Very, very interesting conversation thus far, I can tell you that. And I like the idea that Thomas brought out and you guys agree. Whenever we come back here, you'll be bringing some of your students so that they can show some of what they are into as well. Let me get to the live feed here. John Alfred is writing, I keep seeing made in the USA on the bags of plantain chips. I love buying. So I guess maybe John would want to see made in St. Lucia as well next time she buys some chips or something else. Margot yes. Larocque is writing again. Yes.
Chips, that's me. There are here, we have a few persons because some of our trainees did do some special chips as well.
Okay.
And there are some on the shelves. There are some in Massey. You have to be very particular when you go to look at the different labels and you would find that you would find some made in St. Lucia as well. Yes. So some of them are made in St. Lucia, you know, and people, I guess, what would be fantastic is if that we see much more of our stuff on the shelves. Because we were looking also into seasonings because people love our food because, you know, we do catering, like I told you, to help sustain us and island wide. and they love our food, and they always try to ask, what is it we do and what we put in our food? And a lot of the seasonings that we use. So in every country or every place, you know what, you know, your niche is, you know what your needs are, you know what would attract your people, the culture. And our cultures, though similar, there are certain differences. Like for us, because at NSDC, we do a lot of food, you know, we know that seasonings or something like that would attract others because they want to know what's in our food and they want to buy our seasonings as a result. So sometimes you have to find out what exactly is your niche. Or what are some certain things people would want to get from you most of all? Do you, by the way, have a skills training entity in Dominica?
Well, yes, we have a skills training entity, yes, but not targeting what we are speaking about this afternoon, no.
Oh, okay.
In terms of the agricultural sector. We do other things like building, plumbing, sewing, whatever it is, but not in the agricultural sector.
We do a lot of that as well.
No.
Yeah.
All right. Okay, yes, this person here, Alex Kalai. Good evening, Lofty. I'm watching. Thank you for watching. We read John Alfred already. Margo Larock says here, awesome. Proud of our sister island, that is St. Lucia. John Alfred comes back and say, love cucumber, lemon, sparkling water. Okay. Marianne Pauli writes, pickle some of the vegetables. That is from Pauli. Paulie again writes, dried fruit. My favorite is mango. Okay. Just adding to the conversation. Janice Jajak writes here, green banana porridge. That is what you spoke of earlier. Is something that my parents grew up making. That is how I learned how to make it. And it is very tasty indeed. So one of our persons viewing basically is agreeing with the porridge. The banana porridge can be very tasty at times. Let me see if we get another comment here from, okay, Marshall Lawrence is writing here. I guess you guys touched on some of them already, but we will ask the question nonetheless. Great work to you guys in St. Lucia. How is the cost factor and reasonable profit, transportation, storage, packaging, and shipping, for example? How is that going? I know we touched on, for example, the packaging aspect of it earlier, but he's asking how... reasonable. Are you guys making any profit out of that program?
Well, my financial person would give you more details, but I can
tell profitable?
You that we do. It is profitable.
Yeah.
Because or else we would not stay in it. But what happens is that because we have a lot of persons in the area of Monrepo who buy from us. But before we sell to them, we first sell to Marcy. We have a little, what do you call it, the hatchback car, we call it, that we use, you know, to put our produce in, you know, to take it to the different places. And if that is not available, because we also do catering as well, what we have our training people and our managers, they get traveling allowance and mileage allowance. So they, you know, it would be profitable for us because they use that to take the produce to wherever it is we need it. So it could be cost effective, very cost effective for us as it relates to that. Because if you would have to pay a truck or pay someone to go and take the stuff for you, it is very expensive. So us doing a lot of that by ourselves, also we utilize the students to do the packaging. So we don't have to pay someone outside, you know, and things like that. And, you know, so a lot of some of the things I've done in-house. So, you know, it actually works well to help us, to help our trainees and our students.
Yes, indeed. I also took note that you guys offered some scholarships back then. So that speaks to the profitability as well.
Well, it's about the young people. So when the money's come in, we use it to help them, you know, to come and get a skill. So, you know, we hate to see our young people out there just on the block doing nothing. You know what idle hands get into. So, you know, we really work hard to get that done as well.
Yes. It's already 10 minutes to 6 o'clock. So in 10 minutes, we have to bring it to a wrap. Yes. Wow. Already. Let me move across to Paula and then we'll, you know, kind of bring the conversation to some kind of, you know, wrapping up in just a bit. Paula. Yes.
Yes, Lofty. I was just going to, when you read this, that the person asked about profit, I was just going to tie this into the scholarship because you know, if they are not making profit, then there is no way they would be able to give away so many scholarships. And she also mentioned about the stipend. But lovely, she keeps speaking about the produce. I know they mentioned about the cucumbers and the
relish
porridge made from the bananas. But maybe you can tell us exactly the kind of produce that you keep talking about. Like, is it like Tanya, sweet potatoes, and is like, you know, just maybe for the persons that are viewing us and listening, maybe you can just tell us a little more about the produce that you keep.
Well, we started with simple things like, you know, lettuce, cucumbers. I told you we had done broccoli and all of that. Mm-hmm. We do, you know, during Christmas time, we would really do, because people always look out for the sorrel, white and red sorrel. You know, we would do some of the ground provision, but not as much. The Masi that we sell to like a lot of the vegetables. So we do a lot of different types of vegetables, you know, for the stores so that they fresh, you know, and package them, you know, to sell them. So a lot of it is that, a lot of seasonings as well. The sweet peppers, the seasoning peppers that you use in food, and that's why we use a lot of that in our canteen and the catering that we do, our restaurant. So, you know, seasoning peppers, you know, the tilonyon, you all call it tilonyon too?
Chives,
you know, that kind of thing.
Okay.
You know, and all of these things. So a lot of these, more of these than the other things, but we do some of the other hard foods as well, you know, that we could utilize. So some of that, these are done as well. We have guavas, you know, we have some of the fruit as well that we utilize. So some of these things that we use, and we're looking to go into more food than anything else. So all of that we're working towards to doing more of. But we find that a lot of our vegetables is the things that go fastest and the people need, you know, most of all.
Yeah, Margot Larocque is asking here, do you use an app for the farmer's produce availability?
Pardon me?
Margot Larocque is writing here, do you use an app? An app? Meaning,
no, we don't have an app yet, but I'm sure we should come up with something.
Something, yeah.
We do courses in IT, so hopefully we will come up with something like that. But we just use our ordinary blog for them to log into,
okay,
you know, and all of that online. But we do not have an app yet. We would love to have that.
Okay, good. I guess work in progress.
Yes.
Brother Thomas, before we bring it to a wrap, anything else you want to add?
Well, I know we are coming to an end. And as I said, this is a very interesting story. I love it, what I'm hearing so far. I know Dane spoke, and also Selma, about technology. And the young people are into the digital world and this new technology and want to, you know, technologize the processes and so. Can you speak a little to that? Because, I mean, that's an area that really engages young people's interests. And if that's where we can tap them and get them further interest, that in itself would be good. Can you just speak a little to that?
About the technology?
Of technology, yes. In the whole process.
Okay. Well, in terms of the technologies, what I may have to maybe at a separate time give you a list of all the items that we use. But what we have done is that we've actually been able to work with different organizations to actually source really cost-effective technologies that can be used. For instance, for how to process liquids, how to dry your fruits, etc. So we have this type of, you know, basic, you know, start at home kits, pretty much. I'll refer to this as that. Start at home kits that you can use to do agri-processing. You know, how to process your liquids, how to dry them, etc. So that is what we have access to that information. And we try to ensure that our students are aware of how to utilize, how to purchase them, how to get them, so that they can also go into their own agro processes.
Yeah, because some of them make their porridges and their stuff at home. So some of, you know, what they utilize what we make the cakes with, because they have to be, you know, innovative. They use some of those. to really do their own at-home stuff so they could sell it. Some of them sell from home. So we teach them certain simple things that they could use themselves. What they do with the IT is that they sell their stuff and advertise it online. And they like that aspect of it. So they put it online, they make little blogs. At the NSDC, we teach them IT. So they are able to make their own little blogs and their own little, you know, when they put up their little advertisements,
yes,
and stuff of that for the IT arena. So they do all of that to sell their produce, you know, and you know, these things that they help with. Because knowing IT is important right now. They have to do that because that's where they get most of their clientele from, through online.
Yeah. Just before I ask you guys to for your closing comments, in terms of the composition of the NSDC, you are the PR, Mr. Dane, the general manager is here. Other members include who? In terms of the operation, the setup.
Oh, okay. Well, we do have a lot of different aspects. Apart from agriculture, we have an IT team.
Okay.
With an IS manager. We have our finance team. And they are the ones responsible for the sustainable end of it. So you see, they will be for the evening classes, for the produce and all of that that we do for our sustainable initiatives and our catering and all of that. They are the ones mainly responsible, that IT team, and for all, not IT, sorry, finance team with a different, with an accountant. We also, in that we have the person's responsible for training. So we have a training manager, we have training agents, and we have training officers. The training agents are like the mentors and the persons who work with the trainees as it relates to getting their portfolios and everything in order to make sure they get assessed well for their certification and all of that. And they also help with internships and placements for jobs for those young people. We also, you know, have a counseling team as well. We have both career counseling and psychosocial counseling. Because, you know, when you teach them career counseling and they come in with a myriad of problems, issues. And especially when you're dealing with at-risk youth and people who are disadvantaged, you need the psychosocial aspect. Mm-hmm. And these are responsible for the life skills and the reproductive health and the you know, job search skills and interviewing skills and all of these things that they need to be employable and with work ethics. So he is PR. We have research specialist. We have a monitoring and evaluation officer as well on the team. And we have our sustainable team for catering. So we have a chef, we have cooks, you know, and people, we have the salespersons and on all of that who has to be there. We have a maintenance team also because we believe in trying to fix and do stuff. As a matter of fact, our south building, NSDC, is under rehabilitation because, you know, during COVID, you know, things went down a little bit and we didn't, you know, as it relates to selling, you know, a lot of places were closed, things were closed. So we have some work to do to rehabilitate. So we closed for a short period of time to get back on track. You know, sometimes you have to do that. But these are basically, you know, the team that we have with IT and finance and counseling and all of that, which we believe is very pertinent. The work ethic part means a lot to us. Developing your small business, you know, being employable when you go on the job and all of these things. So that kind of in a nutshell is our team.
Wow. Well, for sure, people, you know, they say when you're having fun, and we are having fun in terms of the information being dispensed, time flies. And it is already 1 minute to six. So I have the privilege now of asking you guys for your wrapping up comments, knowing fully well that you give us your commitment to be back sometime.
Okay, you want to go first?
Yes. So again, it was a real pleasure to be here today. I mean, to share with you guys too. So I'm excited for the next time. So let's hope to have more of those type of collaborations.
Yes.
And again, thank you guys for this evening.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. Well, I would just like to say that, you know, we look forward. We're really happy, you know, that you invited us here. Thanks to Dean. to talk about something that, you know, that will profit all of us. We believe that we are brothers and sisters. And hopefully, you know, we could collaborate in ways where it could actually be beneficial and tangible. It's really important to do that. And I'm looking forward to probably one day even visiting, you know, so that we visiting each other so that we could, you know, start setting up certain things that we do and taking best practices from each other. And with the technical aspect and IT aspect, I love the fact that, you know, we have platforms that we could do that through. And that's one of the things for the young people as well. They love to use the platforms for their businesses as well. So I see Thomas shaking his head. I guess he's looking forward to the visits.
Yes, indeed. So folks, thank you very, very much on behalf of Brother Thomas here, Paula Celestine and the team. I want to thank you guys very, very much for coming on this afternoon and just, you know, selling your product as it was selling yourselves and giving us an idea or ideas in Dominica as to what we should be doing in terms of our agro-processing sector in Dominica. Thank you. Thank you very much. Brother Dean, I love that quote from you. I'm going to use it now. So please do send, you know, your lawyers to me. The money is in the mud. I love that.
I like that too.
All right. So guys, thank you very much.
Yeah. Most welcome.
All the best.
All the best, Paula and everyone.
All right.
Okay. Thank you very much. All the best.
I love this.
All right. Awesome. Thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye. Are you hearing me loud and clear?
Loud and clear, loud and clear. How are you?
I'm doing pretty well, doing pretty well.
I got a little bit of your program.
Okay.
I didn't know what it was all about. I would have stick around, you know, but I went to sleep. Yeah, and what an appropriate song. It says, the poor man of it. And that is gospel truth. The poor man of it. So it's good to be here this afternoon, and hello to all our listeners wherever, people in the diaspora. One big shout out to Ella, who's supposed to be listening right now.
Ella is listening, Pastor. She is listening. She's always on. Yes, Paula is there. Paula is there, and Brother Thomas is there as well. Before we get into the meat of it.
Brother Thomas, who's the one?
Pastor Jack, good afternoon.
A very good evening to you. How are you doing?
I'm okay. What about you? It's been a while.
Yes, we have not cut. I don't know what happened to you. The pandemic is over. We should be connecting closer.
I know.
There is no what is it? Distance.
So but nevertheless, nice seeing you.
Nice seeing you too.
Okay.
Hey, Pastor Jack, how are you doing?
I'm doing all right, my brother. How are you doing?
Good, 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 good.
Nice to see you.
You too.
All right, Pastor Jack, in the interest of time, we know time flies. We have half an hour just about there with you. Let us get into it right away. Tomorrow, the world sets aside the 10th of October as a day where, you know, they recognize the less fortunate persons among us, the homeless, you know, persons who really cannot feed themselves. Right. And I know you're a man, you are in the thick and thin of things in terms of helping out these people through, first and foremost, your organization, your church, and other means. Where do you want to start, Pastor, in terms of the conversation we want to have this afternoon?
I had a shift of mind by seeing one of Embo's videos today.
Okay.
And we were celebrating Pastor's Appreciation Day, and I was in a very festive mood, dancing about. And then I think Ella sent me, I happened to come at the same time to see Ella sent me that video, and it just broke me because one of the things that really brings me down in spirit is when I cannot help, you know, when there is nothing I can do. And finding out, this is one of our cases, and this is one of the cases I've been dealing with for quite a while, and I'm familiar with that. Sometimes when cases like that come and our caseworker says, Pastor Jack, you just have to come and see him. That one today was, I was sad because I didn't know that much. One of the things was that she didn't have a fridge, and it's an elderly person, and we have been doing our best to help them out, and where she was keeping her insulin. That one rocked me. So our caseworkers will be going back there, but the sad part is what she really need to be done. We can't do it. We didn't have the funds to do that, to cover that house and take her out from the tarpaulin. And so that covers just a sample of what happens in Dominica. We make a real big deal about elderly and all the speeches on radio and organizations. But where rubber meets the road, that's not true. In my opinion, Dominica is too much of a small country to have so many neglected elderly people. Dominica, I sat there and a while ago, I thought of what I was going to say. I had no script, no nothing. And I'm just thinking of that special case, and I'm saying, Roseau, this is Goodwill, where the upper class people usually live. And I'm asking myself, do so many committees, associations, churches, and everything, can we all just not come together? I'm not talking about people like me in the countryside. In Roseau, in Goodwill, don't you think there are enough organization, association, cricket club, basketball club, that can pull together and cover and change the situation for this one person? No one of us have it all together, but all of us together have it all. And this is what I've been preaching, that no one organization can do it. And that's why I got in contact with you all. I strongly believe in networking, in that we coming together to do what is impossible. After Maria, I've known more groups than I've ever known before. And I have accomplished, and we have accomplished much more than we could ever accomplish, because of the networking of us coming together. People I have never known, but because we are the same age, we have the same desire, and it breaks me down. When anyone calls and asks for something, because we try to cover from Scotia to Capuchin, and we cannot supply it, especially in the housing area. And we cover every aspect of the human life, whether it's food, clothes, housing. We said that we may not be able to help you, but we might be able to find help for you. And that is what is going on in our association. Not that we boast of any big budget, or nothing. We don't have a big store. We hope one day to have a food bank, Loftus. I've never changed my mind on that. As a matter of fact, I've located the area that we can place those containers for the food bank. It is all down at Maranatha Square. So I know the area, and that is one of the hopes we have. But it could be a basic child that I see on the street. And we call our people ambassadors. That one of our ambassadors would encounter somebody in the bus. We don't care if you're from Lapley. We don't care. But once God allows you to see, God is asking you to do something about it. And you may not have the help that is required, but you can find help. And we're not afraid to beg. Some of the business places in Roseville, like Greens and ISA, have been very good to us. Our last outreach was at Tarish Pete's. So now we have a program running through that. One of them, let me mention that, I we've been asking for people to do that for a long while. Adopt an elderly. What you, just as you can go and adopt a child, a baby, you can also adopt an elderly. And it is costing you nothing. Wherever it is, like it will infringe on you in some way financially, we stand behind you. But all we're asking, if you have a heart for the elderly, you can adopt. And all you do is a simple way. We're asking at least to have a conversation with that person once a month. We ask you if you can pay a visit. If you cannot pay a visit, you get someone to pay a visit and to know all her ills and her pains and just to have somebody to call her. And we have been trying that. I can remember visiting someone and a lady, and I was touched to the point of tears that when we came, we were distributing food around the Rosa area, and then we happened to go there that day. And she said, I don't need anything. All I need is that one of you will just call me, pray with me, call me and just find out who I am. All I need is a call. And this lady, the last call, I think last week, we had a video call. And we had she wasn't alone, it were three ladies, and I was excited. And all, what to talk about? Just to say hello to them, let them know that they matter, let them know that we love them. It is not costing anything. So anyone can adopt an elderly. You go somewhere where I have heard stories from, I can mention things. Love, that's one of the things that I must mention this evening, and I get that platform and opportunity. It's something that breaks my heart all the time. I don't do the cases. We have a special caseworker. Now we have two. And they report and they have to write out a case for us to look at it to see if we can afford that, if somebody's qualified for that. We do as much investigation as we can to make sure the things that we give fall in the hands of a right person. But too often, I know somebody's going to be mad at him saying that. I hear that report. Someone calls and asks or been recommended by somebody. And almost 90% of the time, I hear that statement that just eats me up. And because we didn't vote for them. Elderly people suffer, children, and the statement that closes all our case studies because we didn't vote for them. So we are left alone. We are left to suffer. And too many, almost every case you get, the reason why we are in that situation without a bathroom, without proper toilet, without this, without that, why we have tarpaulin is because we did not vote for them. And every Dominican, like the case we have to do, who tells me you steal And I say it like my mother said, Mama, this is only bad time for you because of a poll election for so many years ago. And you will allow people to be in that state all over Dominica, all over Dominica. And the pictures that we paint is far, far from what is really happening on the ground, because we can give sheets and sheets of paper of every case that we do. And I'm going to repeat myself, and if you have any questions, you can ask me then. Dominica is too small a country for elderly people to be neglected on that height. And the people who paint those kind of pictures on social media, trying to make it look glamorous and it's not true, they are not telling the truth. They're lying. Because we know on a daily basis, there is some elderly person who is neglected, who lives. And I'm going to do the second part of it. I want Dominicans and everybody listening to it. Sometimes the cases we do, the people have us to swear to secrecy, not to report it in the public or to let anybody know that they spoke to us and left us, you will not guess why. You know the next piece of it? Because they support the party. Wow. They don't want me. I look at a video of an elderly person bailing water, and I don't want to give away because their identity is easy. And the person does not want me to say anything to Imo or make sure I don't mention that on our programs on Monday night, because they will know it's they who tell us that, because they are still supporters of the Labour Party. They don't want me to mention, but yet they want our charity to do what their party should have done for them. And I'm telling, these are grave cases. People who are disabled, and I have found people who claim their loyalty, and Pastor Jack, you cannot, make sure you don't say that on your radio. Make sure you don't mention that at all. And none of our workers are supposed to take pictures. We're not supposed to repeat anything we saw with our own eyes and things that they told us. Just because. So these two things are eating me up. That when one tells me, hey, make sure you don't tell nobody, you know, don't tell them this situation you are living in, because their party members will know. Or the other side of the 90% is, we are in that situation because we didn't hold the party. And Dominicans think that is something to smile at. When you don't want to get angry, you cry. You know, I have looked at big men who have brought cases with me, big men. And I can remember going to do a case in a certain village in Dominica. And I brought, and the person who was driving brought me to that, because I had, they said, Pastor Jack, you have to go and see that yourself. I think Imo had made a story about that. And I looked at the young man, we didn't know where to enter in the house. The house had, doors was like windows and windows were like doors. So we came in and they were guiding us so that we wouldn't fall below. And I was looking for the young man. He just stood up there crying, because we couldn't believe what we see. The elderly people of Dominica, the poor man, I feel it. So I am on that campaign to adopt an elderly, until there is no one elderly person in Dominica living in neglect, because all of us can do it. This is not calling for $2.1 billion. This is not calling for a lot of money. It's just calling for us to have a heart to care. And I tell people, I am glad that my mother lived so long. My father died, but my mother lived so long. So anytime I want to play a little fresh, she will remind me. And that she's 92 years old. So I know firsthand what is it to handle an elderly person and what you can go through. But never let, it was an age that caused me to cause us to start that program to adopt an elderly, because I saw things. You know, I asked myself a question. So you mean if we were not in Dominica, I came back to live in Dominica, my sister came back from England, and I said, if we were not in Dominica, this is how our mother would be treated. This is what would happen to my own mother. So that was my motivation to preach a gospel of adopting the people, adopt an elderly, go give them a call. And some of them, we have the problem of contacting them because some of them cannot use a cell phone. And we trying to come up with some means and ways. Sometimes we cannot even work with an elder, we have to work with, and that includes Rosu, Guru, everywhere in Dominica. We have to work with the neighbor. And I want to say thank you to all of you, we call you ambassadors, who help us. You may not be direct members of Open Arms, but you help us. You help us greatly. There is a particular case we have in, and I don't think, I don't want to call her name, we have in Portersville. And when we started our survey in Portersville area and we're distributing food, we came in contact with that lady. But this lady has not been there for herself. When we want the elderly person went to contact us, she's the one who calls. She's the one who's doing all the liaison between us because the elderly person is not able to do that. And right in Loftus, in Rosu, under your nose, you'd be shocked to see what is happening in what we call the little kuwe, the little tracks in Rosu. Go inside there, you know, going inside there. We were, like I said, last week, 2 weeks ago, we were at Parish Pete. And oh my God, oh my God. You know, so maybe this is the time that I think many of our listeners and supporters are listening, and we want to say thank you. We are going to be at the Carib Reserve on the 6th of November. And we expect, and this is Homecoming of Networking. There is a foundation for the Carib people that we are working on. And I'm not against all that festivity for independence, but I really, really, really wish there was a program and there is the big lie that we should make about neglect of the elderly and unfortunate people. We wanted to do that. One of the things we spoke with Ella has a great interest in is mental health and homelessness. Let me give you a story. When I lived in America, I was fortunate to work in a rehab center. And I didn't understand anything. Dominica had nothing really big going on about that time. And I was fortunate that somebody hooked me up. And I went to work there. I would work there anytime on my own day off. I would go there. And that is where I got a wake-up call. That people call, I came back to Dominica with that passion. Because our orientation shocked me. When the man in charge was doing the orientation and his lecture has never left my head, he said, these people that you all are going to be working with are not poor people or uneducated people. And begin to point out they were lawyers, they were doctors, they were all kind of people across the spectrum. And I said, what? And begin to lecture us on how we talk to them, how we look at them, and that we must believe in our heart they can be rehabilitated. And I can remember what shift it was that I went to work. And while I was there, I saw one of the gentlemen going out with a frippy suit and a briefcase in his hand. And I was like, crazy going. And what they were doing was take these lawyers, the doctors or big time executive people who for the sake of one check payment became with a home. And I got to understand, not all homeless people did not have houses. And I begin to understand the concept of a home and a house. They lose their house, but they still had people who love them. They still had children. They had a wife somewhere. And for the sake of some unfortunate circumstance, one paycheck away, and they were homeless. And what the rehab center was doing, that first time I was seeing that, was to rehabilitate them. They would go make interviews, set up interviews for them, apply for a job for them. And we had a dress room. We had them take a shower and dress as an executive. And some of them came back and got the job. And they were back on their feet. In Dominica is that I have learned never to look down at a homeless person. I go to town and I see you homeless. That doesn't mean you haven't got a house. You haven't got a home. But when I go to and find out about you in the country, your mother left the house for you. And there was something your grandfather had. So all homeless people ended up without houses. And the circumstances that brought them there can bring any one of us there. And one of them is mental health. One of them is because they do not even know how to handle. We found a gentleman in Roseau, and you can identify him, but I won't mention, I'll keep it unidentifiable. And what he was doing in Roseau for a living shocked me. And then my colleague, one of my ambassadors, introduced me and told me his history. He was pretty much a wealthy guy in the country with acres of land and a house that his father had left for him. And yet, because of some disturbance, and for a fact, God would have it, I went to his village and found out that he was not a nobody. He had enough wealth that he could live better than you and I. And I have learned my lesson in America. And I came back to Dominica, and I've never looked at a homeless person, a mentally ill person, or elderly. And a country's character, country's worth, is how they treat the unfortunate. And another area that we are paining in is children. Children. I just don't believe, I'm going to say that a million times on the radio, and every time I get an opportunity, every Monday night, I thank those who do, that no child should go to bed in Dominica without food. Not one. Dominica is 2,000 people. I mean, literally, your neighbor knows your business. Your neighbor knows everything. And we have been trying to tell people, well, I said that in our church, come to the church members, if you can stay in your house and you can see that other house, that covers your constituency. That is where you should focus and find out why the child didn't go to school. How did the child go to school? And I know we say you may not be able to help, but you can find help. And that is what we do. We find help for people from whatever part of their life they are suffering. We find it can be medical help. It can be housing. It can be clothing. It can be food, whatever. We just want to make sure that we can, and because I am confident that we can. No child in Dominica. This is a very simple project. Let me give you another one we have. School just reopened. And every child may not have gone to school looking presentable. Simple thing. I call the principal and say, let me tell you something. Are there any children that you yourself feel that was not what the child should be coming to school the first day? And they say, yes. We had Joe Blue in Standard 1, Francisca, I don't know what, and give you 6 people. And I may not be able to buy 6. And I said, what are they missing? Knapsack. They don't have school bags. This child have not been to school for a month without all the books. I don't have all that money to go. But I just call a few people and say, we need 3 bags. You know what happened? Somebody from New Jersey just sent me a whole picture and said, I just went by Kmart and they had all these bags on sale. I bought a whole set to give you. And then I said, yeah, sure. What are we going to do? We're not going to send that in Granby because maybe we have no cases in Granby school, not in Pishley. But I work along with the Pishley student, a Pishley teacher who would be able to connect me to another principal where they have a couple of children in La Plaine or Dailies or Paybush who did not go to school with proper shoes. So what can we do? We get shoes from other places that we can send. Maybe I've never seen the child. I don't know the child. But if the teacher can recommend the child for some kind of help for school books or whatever it may be, that's what we do. So I believe I want to appeal to every church body in the Commonwealth of Dominica. If you are Christian, if you know Jesus Christ, this is not a big harara. That is our job. That is what we are Christians for, that we're supposed to be part of a community where we seek to find the less fortunate. And the less fortunate is in every area of people's life. And sometimes, laughter, it doesn't take much to help somebody. I can see the joy we had in Tarish Pit when we get to Gotha. I mean, the joy. And somebody might hear stories like, man, since David, my mattress wet, or my mattress not good, or they went with all my pots and all my pans, and only two pots I have, only I have no cutlery. And somebody's tired with what they have. And we just send it to open arms, and we get that done. That is not something to give a standing ovation. This is our daily job. This is what we do as Christians. This is what we're supposed to do. It's a call of God upon our lives. And every day I speak, whatever audience I speak, I thank God for my mother who taught me to serve. Today I was coming up from church and that video was playing in my mind. And my mind came on my mother, who had just left home. And I said, well, she did not teach me only to give. She taught me to serve. And the people, anybody who is around me, soon will learn how it is, the joy of serving. If you only give yourself a chance to come back home and know you have helped this lady with her medicine, you have helped this lady. Sometimes if we cannot cover the house, we put two sheets of garbage. The lady didn't have a bathroom. You put two plywood and make like an outside shower for her. You know, some minor things to ease up the life of those around us. We have a good base. Another person I just maybe listening tonight, our ambassador in Fokole, and wonderful people helping us to achieve what we want, because no one person can do all that. But as I network with people all over the island, whether it's a youth group, whether it's a village council, whatever group you have, but our aim is that no elderly person is neglected and no child goes to bed without food in Dominica. That is what we're all about.
If you give a little more than you take, and if you try to fix more than you break, if you're the kind who takes the time to help a stranger in the rain, there's a place for people like you. If you stand up for those down on their knees and lend a voice to those who cannot speak, if you shine a little light, give sight to the ones who've lost their way, there's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold, and when you get there, there's a hand to hold. I believe when your days down here are through, there's a place up there for people like you.
Pastor Jack, you were speaking, and that song came to my mind, in my thoughts, and I just say, before you leave tonight, Pastor Jack, I had to play at least a verse and a chorus, and basically dedicate that song to you in particular, and the persons, your team around you, Pastor.
Mm-hmm. God has provided some remarkable people. I mean, I always knew he would, because love that. I must give you the story of our public pronouncement these days. When I was raised in a particular denomination, and that was very strong in our doctrine, that whatever you do, your right hand do, your left hand not supposed to know. And for many years, when I came to church and was converted to Christianity, I was raised Catholic, but my mother was one of what they call a good Catholic. So to serve and to help was part of the things that I saw to give. So it helped shape my character, not so much about church, but at home. But after a while, I went back to the scripture that was used to say you must not let your left hand know what a right hand. And I read the context as I grew up and realized that it was not about knowing, it was about motive. Why? And because in the same context, it's about you pray by the road and all that. It was about motive. Why do you care? And that is where I changed. And I didn't care about the opinion of other people. That God spoke to me and said, how would people know how to help you if you never tell them you have a charity? So for years, many years, if it's like almost 40 years since, if you put all up to this moment, since we started that, when I came to, I was shocked that there were, because I became a Christian as a young boy, and I was shocked that there was not that emphasis on giving and helping and all that. And we began to do that, and we had somewhere called Docker's Den. Docker's Den was a part of the church that I was very determined to have, and Elijah's Inn. We called that part of the church because we expanded building while I was there. And I said, we need to have one place to rescue people. That if someone, because at that time in Dominica, many times when children are turned to become Christian, their parents will put them outside. And they don't want two religion in their home. And so I said, we must build an apartment in the church called Elijah's Inn. And that stayed there until the river took the church. And then we had Dorcas then, and we found about a woman called Dorcas that made clothes for the unfortunate in the Bible. And we had a place where, and we were not that big yet. And I just knew that should be part of the Christian duty every day. So you could go there and pick up any clothes you want, and when you come, you bring anything you have. That's how small we started. And my niece and I once, we were sitting on our porch by my mother, and we saw a child who we thought, in our opinion, maybe the parents thought it was okay, did not have proper shoes. And from there, that program was born, Soul off the Ground. And we came to church and we announced it, that no child, apart from our church, we started, no child should go to school without proper shoes. It's called Soul of the Ground. And so the sole of your feet. So we began to make sure that every child had the proper shoes to go to school. And this expanding. And after Maria, we said, well, we need to let people know so that they can help. Because there was more, a greater need to help people with their house and, you know, for everything. So that is how we became public. But I think one of my friends called the program and said, let not people think, he doesn't live in Pishlemo. Let not people think that's a new thing. He knew me all in my his life doing that. Mm-hmm. And it's how I get my high. You know, it's just a joy to know that you can be able to help people. And I tell you, it's not so much religion. It's home-based. I saw it. I saw both my father was a very good guy when I get to know him. I mean, he was like that. I mean, he just had a heart. So most of it come from home. I was trained to see giving and helping as part of your development, your character. So it's no sweat for me. It has been all my upbringing. Yeah. And it's people calling.
It's part of your calling.
Part of my calling.
Yeah. Yes, Pastor Jack, we have gone past our time already, but I know the conversation is so interesting. It is so motivating. You always inspire people when you speak. So that is why I decided to give you, you know, some extra time. Let me move across to Brother Alvin and then Paula so that they can, you know, tell you what their thoughts are on what you just said. And then we will ask you to give your contact information, because a lot of persons out there wanting to know your contact information so that they can help with the work that you're doing on the ground, you and your team. Alvin.
Thank you, Lofty. And Pastor Jack, thank you for the work that you're doing. I'm not even sure where to start, what to ask, what to say. But let me, I've used that line many times on this program to say that as a member of JCI International, JC's, our creed, one of the lines. Yes, book of life. And I'm for one believing that Let me just say, I've had, since you've been on the program there this evening, I've had some requests came in, some contacts through my phone, indicating that they would certainly love to adopt an elderly. Ooh. And that, and you have my assurance on that. We are prepared to do as many as three or so, if that's possible, three. And so I will be in contact with you.
Wow. Solo,
and we'll take it from there. That's my commitment on the show. So I just want to say that we have what is called an LOC grouping in the diaspora. And I'm sure once that is presented to them, I'm almost certain that 100% they're going to subscribe to it. So I just want to leave that commitment to you and to say thank you again for the work that you've been doing in Dominica. I think all the areas that you touch, homelessness, mental health, children, hunger, I mean, these are so things that are there to our hearts. And I pray to God that your work will continue and that others, as you say, if many hands chip in, it makes the work lighter.
Amen.
Thank you. Thank you, Brother Thomas. Paula?
Yes, Lofty. I want to say thank you to Pastor Jack. And Lofty, we have had the opportunity to serve with Pastor Jack as well. If you can recall this feeding during the Christmas time in Roseau, and Pastor Jack also in Portsmouth. And I know even there are people, Pastor Jack, sometimes when they see me, they say, when are you all coming back to Portsmouth with all this food? And Pastor Jack, there is one lady in Roseau. Whenever she see me, there is one thing that she always remind me of. That food that day by the arch in Roseau, it was good. The cooks were good. And whenever you all are coming back to serve that food, make sure you tell me. So Pastor Jack, for the persons that are listening and they would like to do some contribution, Pastor Jack, we need to get back with this cooking again. It has been a pleasure being part of your team. Mm-hmm. And I'm looking forward in assisting again, Pastor Jack. So once again, thank you very much for being with us here this afternoon.
Yes, indeed. Pastor Jack, just before I get back to you, one person writing here in the name of Hermilna Watson Duvenet, she's writing, a food bank would be a wonderful idea. And I live in the U.S. and I'll be happy to contribute. So Watson Duvenet, we know that. And so once Pastor Jack requires your information, then I'll pass your information over to him. All right. So your comment is noted and thank you very much.
Loftus, you know, you and I were the first to discuss that, eh?
Yes, indeed. And that is still right up on my agenda.
And keep it there, because I've located one of the things that they are requesting is a location.
Yes.
And I've located a place. And we don't need much of a building if we can get containers. And to do that, because that would be a dream. A place I'm looking for, two things I'm looking for in Dominica is when we have a rehab center and a food bank, you know, where we put people back on their feet, because I don't. Everybody that looks down or is really out yet, we can pull them back up. So that's my faith. Let me say to all of you who promised to adopt or make a contribution towards Oklahoma, the number is 277-1108. So is that correct? 277-01. 0188. Okay, sorry. 277. My wife just corrected me, and that's why you need a what?
I forgot his number.
277-0188. Okay. 277-0188. Correct. I put the one. Everyone. So you can contact me all by my own number. 276-1509. 276-1509. And our next drive is on the 6th of November. We are going to the Canego territory. If one of you have been moved, or some business person hearing that they want to sponsor and start an early Christmas for the people in the Canego territory, we would be happy. Our next outreach is on Sunday afternoons. We go out and distribute whatever we can bring. At the same time, have a good time, especially the children. Give them some snacks and some just to let them know we love them and we care about them. So this is what is up. And Paula, Lofty, I cannot wait for us to go back distributing again.
I know.
We still have some of the cooks around. Some of them migrated, but we still have some good cooks and we can bring some good food. And this Christmas, we hope, Ella must be listening and smiling, boy, that this Christmas we get the years that we
have. Yeah.
You know?
Indeed.
We are back in program with the Granby. The Granby one is an ongoing one that we, every week, the mental health, people mentally ill, is brought to a place where we can help them, that we cook them and feed them, and a group of nurses down there who are most willing to come together. So they work with open arms to be able to do that. And we don't have to get any glory for it. It's, if the work is done, we don't care who we have to partner with, whom we have to team up with. And that's why I got to fall in love with Paula. And because of the enthusiasm and commitment she dedicated, I never forget Paula.
True.
So we work with, and you and Loftus and Ella and all these people who have been working with us, we still want to work with you because together we are better. We do much more. Yeah.
Yeah, Pastor Jack, just before I go to your final comments, in the interest of time here, let me just take some of the comments here. Plenty of persons are commending you and your work on the ground with, alongside your team. Clarilyn Warrington is writing, thanks to you, Pastor Jack. Well done. Also, Medora Lewis is writing, thanks, Loftus. Great program. Well said, Pastor Jack. Thank you for the work that you all are doing. God bless you all. That is from Medora Lewis. Didi Easter writes here, times two, thank you, Pastor Jack, for the great initiative. God bless you and all your efforts. She continues to write, we know the caring spirit is still among our people. We just have to tap into it again. Keep loving and caring for each other again. That is from Didi Easter. Valda Eloa writes, kudos to you, Pastor. The other pastors in Dominica should take a leaf from your page. Janice Chaplis writes, God bless you, Pastor Jack. Let me see if I could get some fresh names here in terms of comments here. Janjan Joseph is writing, it's a great joy to give, such a beautiful feeling. Thank you, Janjan, for those comments here to Pastor Jack. Judy Charles St. John writes, good initiative, Pastor Jack. You are one of the few caring ones left. May God continue to bless you and your endeavors. And trust me, Pastor Jack, the comments continue to come in, but in the interest of time, we have to, you know, kind of take a wrap on it here. So your final thoughts, bro. Thanks for talking to us this afternoon.
I say what I have practiced in my religion very often to say, no one of us have got it all together, but all of us together have it all. So I pray that the hearts of many are stirred, and no matter how small or little or big, you can contribute towards the well-being of another person. That's why you came on this planet for. And another thing I said, the cases that you have done, it's amazing that some of the people who never thought they would have gotten themselves in the position did. So let us put our hands and our hearts together and let us try to touch the children and the disabled and the elderly of Dominica. God bless. Thank you very much for inviting me today for doing the program. It's my job.
All right. Pastor Jack, thank you very, very much on behalf of the many persons listening and viewing. Continue to do good work, brother.
God bless.
Thank you.
Thank you, Pastor Jack.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Good evening. We'll be
God bless.
Okay.
All right, folks. I know that we have, well, I have some requests to play that song in the entirety, that song that speaks about people like you. At the end of the program, we'll be playing that song in the entirety just for your listening pleasure out there. It is already 15 minutes to the hour of 7 o'clock. We basically stole 15 minutes from Brother Thomas's time. Paula, we hope we don't get a sanction.
It was a
for that. Okay.
No, it was a worthwhile stealer.
All right, cool. So we are now on the third segment of our program where Brother Thomas will take the lead as to where CC, Civic Vibes, that is. I'm in a tongue twister, Civic Vibes and CCJ, too many C's, where we continue right here to monitor, scrutinize, keep the focus on the summer report from the CCG sometimes back, where they said Dominica elections have been tainted through corrupt practices, and no longer should we continue with those elections in Dominica. So, Brother Thomas, it's all yours till about the 7 o'clock hour.
Thank you, brother. Thank you, Lofty. Thank you. Let me see how I can do that within the time frame. But I think the two segments we had prior to my segment was very, very, very interesting, very interactive. Our friends here from St. Lucia and Pastor Jack. I mean, I'm cool. I think it was information and an engagement and a conversation that was worth having. But let me just say, on that particular area that we are now, I want to pretty much take I want to focus and take a different approach. Bearing in mind and keeping in mind the CCJ, because we can't lose our sight of the CCJ report. We must never and should never lose sight of that report. And like they've said, we need to address the matter before next general election. The question that always comes up is that, who's going to bail the cat? Who's going to do it? Who's going to ensure that those areas that need to be looked at are looked at? Who's going to come forward? Is it Lofty? Is it Paula? Is it Alvin? Is it John? So what I have attempted to do, and it's interesting that in our segments earlier, the emphasis was on young people, the youth, through that program that is undertaken in St. Lucia. And to some extent, I would say, based on what Pastor Jack has just presented, he made mention of Ella and a number of other persons. And these two are young persons who are showing their involvement or engagement. So as we continue the conversation today on electoral reform, I would like to focus on our youth in Dominica. I'm going to put the challenge to them as the ones who need to take the lead on electoral reform. The United Nations defines youth as anyone between the age of 15 and 24 years old. For purposes of our conversation today, though, I'd like to extend that age, and I would say anyone under 40 years of age. And why I am extending it that far, I would like to think that anybody listening to the program this afternoon and those who may get the information afterwards might want to ask themselves some very deep question. Those who are 40 and under 40, where do I stand in the overall scheme of things today? A 40-year-old in Dominica, 40-year-old young man or 40-year-old young woman, what's my economic being like? What's education-wise? Have I gone to study? Do I want to go and study? Do I not advance my education? Is there a technical skill I would like to learn? What about my health? What about job opportunities? What about business opportunities? Is there an idea I have I would like to undertake? So, for these young persons who are 40 years today, as we speak, what are their own emotional, social, spiritual, what is that going to be like 2 decades from today? So if you're 40 years, you've lived under a government for 20 years, what's your life going to be 2 decades from today when you turn 60? Is there a plan afoot for that? How engaged are young people in the socioeconomic and political life of their country? Should they be engaged? Should they have a responsibility to be engaged? Does it affect them whether they engage or not engaged? Do you have a role in the promotion, development of democracy and peace? The young people in Dominica, the Caribbean population as of 2020-21 was a little over 43 million people, 43,199,000. And that is more people than the population of Canada. Canada is a little less than that. The adolescent age population, that is 10 through 19, which is considered adolescent, is 7.2 million. The youth population, which is 15 to 24, is 7.1 million. And the young person's population, which is 10 to 24, is a little over 10 million. So although our last census was done in 2011, we don't, as I understand it, there's a current move to do a new census, which is what, 12, 11 years ago? I would submit that in all situations in Dominica, we do have a very young population. We simply have to walk the streets of Roseau or check the blocks in the various communities, and we'll see the number of young persons who are on the block, unemployed, on the street, or all over the place, involved in unnecessary activities, which include, unfortunately, crime. So we have a very young population. Of the combined, let me put it this way, of the combined 2.4 billion young youth population of the Commonwealth, 60% of that represent age under 29 years old. So I'm saying all of this to say that the largest chunk or the largest percentage of our population in any of the jurisdiction are young people. And if that population comprises of young people, then it begs the question, what role do they have in the electoral process, in the political process, in the social process of the country? Just less than a month from today, Lofty, we'll be observing 44 years of independence. Imagine for a moment a youth who was 24 years of age at the time of independence would now be 44 years of age. Okay? A youth who was 24 years of age, okay, since our independence, would now be 44. How do you assess your accomplishment? How do you assess your accomplishment? A functioning democracy, as we have said on this program before, requires a responsive institution, but active citizenry.
Alvin, just run that line again, the 24 and whatever you said. I think you had your wires crossed. But just run it again. I'm asking you to just run that line again. I think I heard something that, you know, needs correcting. A youth that was 24 when you said?
A youth that was 24 years of age at independence is now 60, my bad. 60.
Okay, correct. Okay, yes. Years old. That's it.
Okay. 68 years old. Okay. In my view, as I've said before, young people care about democracy. We tend to say, well, oh, young people are not, they don't care. Young people are not into that. Young people don't worry and all that kind of stuff we say. But the examples of the recent election in St. Kitts and Grenada attest to the fact that young people are engaged. If given the appropriate opportunity, if allowed to get engaged, they can become engaged. Let me just share with you briefly the from the Grenada experience, what obtained in Grenada during the last election, which was held a couple months ago. The voter turnout in Grenada, there was a total of 86,658 enrolled voters, out of which 60,630 cast their vote. That was 69.96% voter turnout, almost 70% voter turnout. Okay? The the young man who won his party, the young Mitchell guy who won in the St. David's Parish or wherever he ran, he got 4,414 votes out of the 7,189 persons who cast their vote. So he got a little over 61% of the vote, 61.40. Okay? The former Prime Minister Mitchell, in his constituency, where you had a total of 2,295 persons who cast their vote, he, Mitchell, got 2,211 votes. So he got 96.34%. See the amount of votes he got? Now, Mitchell was seeking to do a sixth term in office, one of the longest serving prime minister. And prior to that election that was held this year, the NDC, the Mitchell party had won all the seats previously. So the NDC, which won now under this young man, lost, had zero seats in the 2013. And when they went into the election of 2018 again, he didn't win any seats. He had zero. Two consecutive elections. The point I'm trying to make here, Lofty, is to say that young people can and do have the ability to change things. They can do it in Dominica. And let me just share with you a little statistics again as we come to the end. In 2014, in our elections in Dominica, the following constituency recorded below 55% voter turnout. And here are the numbers. Granby, a voter turnout of 44.14%. Marigot, a voter turnout of 46.27%. That's in 2014. Portsmouth, a voter turnout of 50.89%. Rosa Central, a voter turnout of 50.10%. Wesley, a voter turnout of just a little over 52%, 52.87%. Rosa North, voter turnout of 53.41%. Salisbury, 54.36%. Cottage, 54.83%. St. Joseph, 54.94%. All of those constituencies were well below 55%. The general election of 2019, voter turnout was 54.40%. Remember I told you in Grenada, they were almost 70%. What does that say about young people's engagement in the political process? I would say that the challenge for our young people in Dominica now is to get engaged. Make use of your smartphone, Snapchat, WhatsApp, Facebook, YouTube, TikTok, Twitter. Seize the opportunity and deal with one aspect. You know one aspect they can deal with? They can begin to look at the voters' list. They can begin to exchange ideas on that with each other in their community. They can begin to tweet about it, make videos about it, find out who's going to a constituency and get that list and view the names, get on their smartphone, get into their WhatsApp, get into their technology, as our folks from St. Lucia said, and do some of that work. And start getting that engagement on the ground. They can do that. That's their area. 9 out of the 21, as I mentioned, were well below 55%. So as we go into our 44th year of independence, I'm challenging our young people to take a look of where you are today as a young man of 40 or under 40, what you have achieved economically, socially, and use whatever talent you have. And let's ensure, as the CCJ report says, that we can have an election that is free that is fair, that is transparent. I believe together we can create the Dominica we want to live in, with a democracy that truly represents all of us as citizens of Dominica.
All right, indeed. Thank you very, very much, Thomas, Brother Thomas here, for your fine words here in terms of just echoing the sentiments of the CCG Law Lords, as it were, talking about our elections in Dominica. And by the way, just to strengthen that point, that list that Alvin's just spoke about, it is all people. So those of you out there listening, please encourage somebody as well to just take a look at that list that is out as of the 30th of September, yes, this year, so that you can verify the names on there. You can play a part, as Alvin is alluding to. Paula, we are basically out of time, but it would be remiss of me if I don't give you, your final statements, your parting words, Paula, as we bring the program to a wrap in just a bit.
Well, yes, Lofty, Alvin have said it well. And time and time again, we continue to echo these sentiments about our voters list and what we believe a number of young persons should really take the advantage of. But there is one thing I always keep saying, Lofty, there's a number of young persons in this country. They do not make the proper use of those cell phones that they have. Because if more young persons, or Dominican in general, was maybe reading a little more and listening to a little more news, you know, things that matters a lot, then they would have it right. But I will say, like Alvin, that the CCJ report, Dominicans, and I being a Dominican and I continue to echo this sentiment, that I believe we need the right things here in Dominica, and we need to do the right thing before we go to any other election. So Lofty, once again, thank you very much for this opportunity as usual. And to all the persons who have stayed with us on the live, I wish you all a good week. Yeah, Lofty, thank you. Thank you.
All right, folks, thank you very much indeed. Paula, yes, we'll just have at least a 2 or 3 minutes chit chat before we end in totality here. We have the very unfortunate news that is we heard today of the passing of Dominican in the name of Mr. Philbert Bertrand. So we can just wait on that. You know, we want to extend our sympathies to his family and friends at this time. We know they're going for a very trying time. And so we want to, you know, just spend at least 2-3 minutes just to pay him some homage at this time. Paula, you want to go first?
Well, yes, Lofty, I too want to extend my deepest condolences to his family, his close friends. Philbert Bertrand is a former police officer of the Commonwealth of Dominica Police Force. I've known Philbert for a number of years, maybe pretty close to about maybe 25, 30 years. Mm-hmm. And I think he served well. And I know he will be missed by a number of persons. But Lofty, there comes a time when the good Lord say you have to go, you have to go. There's nothing that you can do. So at this time, I want to wish the family, close friends, and members of the police force, I want to say, take your strength from the Lord. Also, Lofty, the ice pop lady in Layu, at Layu, she have lost one of her sisters. So I too want to extend my deepest condolences to her. And also my very good friend down there, that's her sister as well, Shirley Mills, in the Layu area. I want to say, keep the faith, hold strong, and everything, God is able. Thank you, Lofty.
Thank you very much, Paula. Mr. Thomas, did you know Mr. Bertrand?
Oh, yeah, certainly. I know him very well. I know his dad very well. His dad was a former chief of ambulance. Yeah, Mr. Bertrand, my good buddy. Good friend. And I know Philbert very well too. And so I too want to extend my sympathies to the family and friends. It's a sad time for them, but like you say, just, you know, keep the faith and the good Lord giveth, the good Lord taketh. So all the best.
Yes, indeed. And again, one last note here. Tomorrow is recognized as Flag Day in Dominica. So we want to encourage everyone to, you know, bring along a flag with you tomorrow as we in Dominica recognize the importance of our flag in Dominica, designed by Mr. Alwyn Bully. Indeed. All right, Dominicans, that is it for us. That is where we must bring the program to a wrap. But let's play this number that we started earlier, Someone Like You from Morgan Heritage. And we're going to bring the program in a wrap in just a bit.